It's a well known, I'm sorry if you know it, I used it two, three times in my books. It was also used already by many philosophers, even Derrida. I know Derrida used it. A joke about Jews gathered in a synagogue on Sabbath to publicly declare their failures or whatever. And first a mighty rabbi says, "Forgive me, O God, I am nothing, not worthy of your attention." After him, a rich Jewish merchant says, "Forgive me, O God, I am a worthless nothing." Then a poor ordinary Jew steps forward and says, "Forgive me, God, I am also nothing." At that point, it doesn't matter who, the rich merchant steps, a rich rabbi, and says, "But who this guy think that he is? He thinks how dares he also to claim that he is a nothing? Or we are the nothing." That's the white liberal lie today. I literally experienced the same situation already 25 years ago at a very politically correct conference where white liberals were excelling each other into who will humiliate himself more. We are to blame everything. Oh, Eurocentrism, we brought slavery, it's nightmare, we are guilty of everything. Christianity, the worst one, it was invented to screw other races and so on and so on. And then a black friend of mine, not to embarrass him, I have not mentioned this, he said, "Well, wait a minute, guys, we are not so innocent. We also had our own Louis Farrakhan, black racism and so on." And I noticed that the mighty white liberal professors exchanged these embarrassed gazes, which meant precisely, "No, sorry, guy, we are to blame, we are nothing. Who are you to say that you are also nothing?" The message was clear. Precisely when white liberals humiliate themselves, and I noticed this again and again, we are worthless, we don't have the right, that's a subtle racism expressed in this form. If you are an exotic nation, if Native Americans dance their tribal dances and so on, that's perfect, they are asserting their particular identity. If I say, "Let's assert German identity," "Oh, you are a Nazi, you are a fascist." Okay, I know in what sense this is true. But nonetheless, there is something false in it. Why? Because denying you the right to your particular identity, in this false sense, humiliating yourself, means that in a much more subtle way, you reserve for yourself the universal position. I notice again and again how this same white liberals who are ready again and again to humiliate themselves, "We are the worst, we are guilty of everything," and they like to play this game. Whenever that something horrible goes on in third world countries, it must be a consequence of colonialism, you know, which, as a black friend that I have from Nigeria, once he exploded and said that this is the worst racism he can imagine. They treat us, he told me, like children. We are not even allowed to be evil on our own. If we are evil, it must be effect of colonialism and so on and so on. And that's why I claim white liberals love identity politics. It means minorities can have their particular identities, but we renounce our identity, but we keep this role of guardians of universality. Which is why, I wonder if this is also your experience, it's my regular experience that this same self-humiliating white liberals have no problem of correcting minorities if they perceive their position as wrong. "Sorry guys, you fell into colonialist trap here, this is not the right way to talk about it," and so on and so on. So that's why my advice is the one already elaborated, I've written about this a lot, I will not repeat myself. It's the one of Malcolm X. He was a true universalist. I'm sorry if I repeat myself here. Malcolm X, it was a Hegelian stroke of a genius. He emphasized it. X doesn't mean, white people stole from us our roots. Yes. But his point is not, so let's regain our roots and look for some original tribal identity in Africa. No, he saw this being deprived of roots, we don't have our particular identity, as a unique chance for the black people to propose a new universality which will be much more authentic and radical than white people's universality, which is still a false universality. Always remember this. The true struggle is the struggle for universality. And liberals like to transform, mystify this struggle into the struggle of particular identities, where then they can play their game, you know, of your particular identity, my particular identity, let them coexist, and so on, and so on. No, the problem today is the struggle of universalities. We have traditional liberal universality, which is the universality of particular modes of life, but the problem is, how do you define the universal dimension? The problem with particular identity politics is that it never can be all of your position. Every particular identity politics implies a universal dimension of how you construct the space in which particular identities coexist. Traditional version is the one of legal illusion. This was, otherwise I respected him, Richard Rorty's position, that people should be allowed their particular identities, and the only universal frame is liberal law, which organizes society in such a way that we all tolerate each other, and so on and so on. I find this vision of particular identities and universality catastrophic. I think that precisely, here I remain a Marxist, what interests me is not my particular identity against your particular identity. It's the antagonism of my particular identity, the antagonism of your particular identity, and can we link our struggle against our own oppression, domination with yours? Can we link my antagonism with your antagonism? That's why, to conclude, in spite of all his failures and so on, I see something nonetheless unique. I don't have any great hopes of it. Probably it will alter and wrong, but I like this idea of Bernie Sanders plus the squad. Because we get what? We get young, non-white women, radical politics, and then we get Bernie Sanders, an old white man. It's a winning coalition, okay. What Bernie Sanders got, I know, I was not in contact with him, but in Burlington I often go there with his people, and they said his obsession was for long years. For us, we should precisely also aim to get the votes of those disappointed poorer white people who would have otherwise voted for Trump or whoever there. That's the winning coalition today. Don't sacrifice any of the two sides. If you do sacrifice old white men, not in the racist way, but in the sense of all those who feel betrayed and so on, then you will get, with all your political correctness and so on, you will get Trump re-elected again and again. Again, I want to get not just rid of Trump. My message, and this is what caused so many misunderstandings, is that don't just fight Trump. Ask the crucial question. We lived till 10 years ago, maybe even less, in something like liberal hegemony. We had right-wing version, left-wing version, Republicans, Democrats. But basically it was a very homogeneous space. Then Trump happened. How could this have happened? What was wrong with the white liberal hegemony? The only way to really defeat Trump is to ask this self-critical question. If you just focus on Trump, you get caught into liberal nostalgia for the good old princely times and so on and so on. Just to conclude with my usual story, that's why I don't agree. I find it deeply problematic, Handmaid's Tale, the novel. It's, I think, what, of course I am also horrified by this convincing depiction of male fundamentalist terror and so on and so on. But what bothers me is this one, is this thing. I think that Handmaid's Tale is basically a work of what Frederick Jameson called nostalgia for the present. It paints a near future of fundamentalist rule, and it makes us feel well. And you see, haha, we are not yet there, we are still in a liberal society. No, the true question is, but, and it's never addressed in the novel, but how comes that out of this liberal paradise, Republic of Gilead exploded? Or for us, how comes that Trump exploded? We should be critical towards ourselves. Otherwise, Trump, if there will not be some catastrophe, which would be a nightmarish new world war or whatever, Trump will get re-elected. So my paradox is that it's not what democratic establishment is telling us. The only way to win Trump is to be more moderate, to get centrist votes. No, this was what Hillary tried, Clinton, and she lost. The paradox is that the only way to really win over Trump is to get the votes of all those, metaphorically called, old white men, poor guys who feel dispossessed and so on, and we only can get their voices by moving more to the left.